All right, what's up, ladies and gents? It's your boy Murda in the house. We are coming to you live tonight, or just myself and the party cam there. Let me make sure they're blaring perfectly. We got this dude from Sea of Thieves. I got in my loot box. He's cool. Anyway, we're chilling tonight. It's Div A, Div A West. These are the top two teams from this division about to face off and see who's going to be number one. Whoever wins this match will move into first place in Division A West. It's Team Freelo up against the guys from Texas A&M, Team Maroon. I'm going to see if these teams are ready because they are in the lobby and we are 1 minute past their start time currently. So let's see what they have to say. I think we have the crowns correct. Team 2 draft. All right. Let me pause for a second. Before we get any further, I do want to note what the bans of the maps were tonight. Winning the coin toss was Team Freelo. They banned out Towers of Doom. Then Team Maroon banned away Tomb of the Spider Queen. The first map we're going to be going to is Dragon Shire, and we're going to finish out the night on Cursed Hollow. Ladies and gents, these teams are ready, so let's get right into it. And my game is not showing up. There it is. Okay, it showed up. All right, everything looks good. Da, 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 da. Yeah, okay, cool. Yeah, super hype. So thank you very much, everyone, for joining tonight. This is bound to be a good game. Both these teams showed during week one that they could win. And Team Maroon also has a tie on the record. I don't know exactly which order those went in, but they have 7 points. Team Freelo currently has 6 points. So, again, if someone wins 2-0 tonight, they are the top team in the division. So, very exciting. Let me start making a poll here. Who will win Dragon Shire? All right. And option one will be Team Freelo. And add that. And option two will be Team Maroon. Add that and start. Now let's take a look at these bans. So we did see Team Maroon ban away the Phoenix, which has been obviously a very high priority on the ban list for all of the teams in NGS. And we also see the Garrosh getting banned away, which is another one of those heroes that, oh my god. Wait, did you sub to me, Bobo? It didn't come through on my thing. Didn't show up on my recent events. What is this? What is this, Bober? What is this? Well, anyway, I appreciate it if you did do the sub arena last night. Oh, there it is. Hold on. Let's see. Look. A new subscriber. Yeah! I just had to hit refresh on it. It was on my other list. Hell yeah, Bobo. What up? And a 250 bits. 250! 250! That's what's up, man. Appreciate it. Remember, any bits you guys donate this season while I'm casting are going directly towards the prize pool for the Regen Invitational. There is a goal at the bottom of my, I don't know if I can point to it that way, but you'll see it. Yeah, that little bar, let's fill that baby up and let's have a cool tournament before season 5 starts after the off-season period. Alright, so let me get back to this draft. We had Hanzo pick first. Dragon Shire, great hero on Dragon Shire. Actually love him here. Maiev was left for Team Freelo, and they also got the Stewcop to pair with it. So that Warden's Cage has a little bit of combo synergy with the Lurking Arm. Love to see those two heroes synergize. And yeah, it's a pretty cool pick. I think Maiev is, we saw a stat today on my team that said the early game Maiev is so strong that if you can win games early with her, her win percentage is just like through the roof, and the later and later the game goes, Maiev's win rate falls almost linearly. So if you're Team Freelo, you got to keep that in mind. You got to try to win this game early. Malfurion and Johanna. So here's something cool about Johanna when you're playing up against that Warden's Cage is you pop your iron skin and you could just walk through all of the little barriers on that Warden's Cage and pop them off your team to escape. So I like having Johanna. Obviously, the Iron Skin is just super cool to have. Malfurion, one of the strongest healers in the game. They wanted to make sure they got it before it got banned away. So pretty, pretty cool. So Lucky says, Murda RG, have Bobo hop in the cast. I mean, if he wants to. He didn't say he wanted to. So...
Dripping the bits.
I'll just let him hang in chat and do that. Okay, the bands are Diablo and a Jaina. I do like the Diablo band. I think this is another one of those maps that he's really good at. There's a few really good choke points, especially around the siege camps on both sides, that he can really dominate if he gets off a really good APOC. Plenty of walls there to charge into as well. Nem Avenger in the house. What's up, my man? How are you doing? And the Jaina, another one of those heroes that pairs really well with my F. So surprised to see them banning it away, because I think you can get some pretty good value out of having that Ring of Frost comboed inside of that Warden's Cage. But nonetheless, they're going to ban it out, and I'm sure they have another mage in mind that they want to get to pair with this Maiev. Maybe not a mage. It looks like it's going to be Junkrat, and yeah, I really like this. I think the Rip Tire thrown inside the Warden's Cage is really cool. New follower coming through. It is XVX Hanyu. I actually casted you last night. Thanks for stopping in. And a host coming through from Isaiah. Appreciate that, one viewer.
Host connection detected.
Man, you NGS people are too nice to me. Really appreciate the love. Really appreciate it. And of course, Sonya to pair with the Junkrat, which is one of the heroes I get to play quite frequently on regen, and has a very dominant matchup against most heroes up in that top lane. So we'll see if they want to counter with something like maybe a Malphiel or Leora can have some success there. So we'll see what they're thinking, but Sonya could give them trouble up in that top lane. If you're Team Arun, you really got to think about this pick here and how you want to play up against her. And of course, the Junkrat is going to give his own issues of his own down there with the four man, and plenty of poke to get onto that Hanzo. So it will be Malphiel, and a hero you don't see too frequently anymore. It's going to be Tassadar. So yeah, this is pretty cool. Are they going to use the Force Wall to set up some little bouncy points for Hanzo arrows? Maybe. Sounds fun to me. I'd like to see it. One more pick. Has to be a tank. Must be a tank here for Team Freelo. Dragonshire is the map. Banned out is Diablo, and Garrosh already picked was Johanna. So does this leave a Mirrodin? Will Mirrodin be the pick, or an ETC also available? A few options. Not super choked out. There's a lot of tanks available in this meta that can play pretty well. I think it is whittled down right now to Mirrodin or ETC. And if I had to pick one for them, I think I'd go with the Mirrodin. Although he does have a lot of trouble in the Malphiel, but I mean, any tank really will. So we will see which direction they want to go, and it will be Varian. This boy with the casting mic did not see that one coming. Hollis, the captain, gonna play on the Russian skinned Varian. Gotta love it. Keeping warm in the winter, even though it's still spring. And yeah, so draft of game number one. What do you guys think? If you want to vote, use exclamation point vote and your pick. I will show you. Use vote and zero or one to pick your team to win this map, period. Team Maroon. All right. All right, we are in draft. Let me switch it over to the scene right now.
Prepare for combat.
All right. Alright, on the left-hand side, we have Team Freelo. Richard Gear on the Stukov Skigum playing Maiev Hollis, the captain, on that Varian. Blackout, gonna play Junkrat, and Tithly thing-ma-dooby-dooby-dee on the Sonya. I was gonna say Tithel. On the right-hand side, we have Team Maroon Space Baking to play Malfurion. Edgardo, GL, gonna play the Malfiel, excuse me, Blanket, that is a weird spelling, is going to be on Johanna. Samael is on the Tassadar, and rounding it out is Coca-Cola on the Hanzo. So let's take a peek at your level one talents here in this matchup. We have Johanna moving into Laws of Hope. We're going to have that heal. And we do have the Bonds of Justice build started by Maiev. So you're going to look to pull in some heroes with that Humble Brind. Get those stacks off. Varian already working on his overpower. A little parry block stacks and stuff. He's going to get all that extra refreshing going on. And Sonya. This is unique because it's Furious Blow at level one. And that's going to be what she wants to use to battle up against Malfiel in the top lane. Let's take a look already. And Tythel, what did we say? I think we said Tythel. Tythel already chunking out Edgardo quite a bit. Teams in the four man are rotating pretty well, alternating lanes right now. Let's see if this aggressive rotation, the bush is scouted. There's an Umbra bind. Silence does come out. Iron Skin popped by Johanna. She's able to scoot back behind her wall to safety. Of course, Tassadar there with the Malfurion. There's plenty of support available here for Team Maroon. Looking around, siege damage pretty standard so far. Tassadar actually doing quite a bit for his team in the red trunks today. And here it is, the first shrine phase spawning. Bot side is just going to be Hollis, that variant, all by himself. He's not really a tank quite yet, so he has to be careful. Can't be too aggressive without his healer nearby. And there it is, Stukov showing up. The silence will be played. Once again, it's on Johanna, and she is not scared of nothing. There's Hollis falling low. The zoning roots were so good there. Well played by Space Bacon. Now, I had the pleasure of getting to cast Team Maroon earlier in the season along with Jayzon over at twitch.tv/JayzonHots. We had a good time casting them, and Space Bacon was a huge playmaker for this team. And already here, early in game one, seeing those roots come out in the perfect spot to lock down the kill on Varian up top. We got Sonya duking it out with Malfiel. Why do I always want to say Malfurion when there's both the heroes in the game? That's Malfiel. Low on mana. Sonya's going to be able to whirlwind, get some of that health back. And she did go into Battle Rage at level 4, so she'll be able to also heal with one of her talents. Back to the mid side. Hollis here. Gonna keep an eye on the Dragon Shrine here in the mid, because both shrines, top and bot, are captured by Team Maroon. And there goes Tassadar with the channel silenced by Richard Gear at the last second. So very well played, and we'll see if Tassadar wants to move back on it. But bot side was recaptured at least halfway by Team Freelo. Blackout and Skigum there on the Maiev and Junkrat. We'll see. Excuse me there at the camera play. We'll see if these teams want to make a different trade out in these lanes. It looks like so far, surprisingly so, Sonya's winning that. Even though we do have Die Alone at level 4 from the Malfiel. I missed a kill. Oh my god. Sorry. We did have Hanzo fall there. I wish I knew what happened. It looks like a variant taunt must have been it. Resetting some of those redemption stacks. He is back to zero. Stukov looking for the channel, but there is a ranged boy here. These little ranged boys, they see him and they say, no, you're not taking the dragon from our team. Top side, we missed it again. It's Malfiel. And at this point, chat, you can throw T-Tours out there because your caster is missing things left and right. But we do have kills being traded from both sides. It is 6-6 in levels, and the Dragonite was grabbed. Let's get a siege down this mid wall. This is what they want to do. They want to open up the mid wall. They're probably going to rotate down to the bot as well. Make sure they get some structure value with this first Dragonite, who really doesn't have too much power in this early game. Only 4 minutes in. So we'll see if they want to at least get the sieging pressure in the bot and mid. They already got this mid down. I'm surprised they're not seeing the rotation come out. They are looking for the gank up top onto Malfiel. I do want to show this because I am not going to miss another kill this game if I can help it. Hollis was up there on the Varian looking to get the taunts off, but didn't quite happen. Dragonite down in about 10 seconds. Gonna get what they can on this wall. Tassadar doing a great job shielding him to make sure that damage is not going directly on. Blanket, the Johanna getting kicked away. And there it is, one tower, and the Dragonite will expire. Stukov scooting back to safety. And right away, Sonya was ready to jump on this Bruiser camp, so those will be captured very quickly for Team Freelo. So far, I gotta say, this is very even. We saw both teams hold the shrines for at least a moment. We even saw them in pregame with the same exact portraits, the Pachamari portrait. And I gotta say, I was a little confused when the lobby opened up because I was like, wait, who's on Team Freelo? Who's on? I had to load up the roster just to find out. They were very nice and helped me too, but Siege gonna be captured for both sides. It's actually the Bruisers up top and the Siege on the bot side on alternate sides of the map. So I think this should favor, well, they do have Balthiel and the Task Dark committing to this clear. So we'll see. Maybe they can land a taunt here onto this Hanzo who's playing aggressive. Nope. Gonna get back to safety. Coca-Cola knew that his team was telling him to get back. Gets back to his wall just fine. And not too much happened with those camps. Both teams are, though, very close to picking up level 10. And this is where some of these teams are gonna start getting dangerous, because that Dragon's Arrow from the Hanzo is going to be very deadly if they can get it paired up with maybe even that Twilight Dream from the Malfurion bot side. We do see Knights being collected here by Team Freelo. Hollis holding the anchor point, and it looks like no issue. They will grab them, and all level 10s have been picked except for this Malfio who's holding right now. We do see Warbringer, which is not his actual ultimate, but Wrath of the Berserker. Massive shove. Huge Umbral Bind into the Silence. The Junkrat gonna knock him back. Blanket is in trouble now, getting taunted by the Varian, but can they body block her in? And they do. The Twilight Dream is not enough to save the life of their tank. Johanna gonna be the first to fall in this battle, and with Siege Giants here and a man advantage, this is likely gonna be a fort, and indeed there is absolutely nothing Team Maroon can do to save this one. The Knights and the Siege Giants working that down very quickly. Big pickup there on Johanna for them. Up top, Sonya just finishing off that Bruiser camp that was picked up by Team Maroon. And will possibly want to start working up onto the shrine, but has to be careful. About 60% health, and that Malfio has been very deadly, especially with that die alone at level 4. We'll see if Edgardo wants to make the play, but instead, no. Looks like there's a fight breaking out on the bottom. It's Varian taunting, and there is a huge Warden's Cage. Is the Silence going to come out? There it is now. Pulled back in, stuck in the Silence, and the Riptire. That's a 2-for-nothing right now in favor of Team Freelo. Tassadar, the next to go start falling low, and we missed it up top because this action in the bot is too exciting, but Sonya also picked up the Malfio on the top side. Samuel, the Tassadar also gonna fall. Make it a 4-for-nothing for Team Freelo and their second dragon of the game is surely to be picked up. Maiev making her way over. Skigum collecting it for Team Freelo. And now it is time to get more forts down. Still, two heroes missing on the map for Team Maroon. The Dragonite already on this mid fort. They're here in desperation to try to save this, but there is nothing they can do because this dragon is definitely strong enough to clear this. And now the next question we gotta ask is, where will it move? Does it want to stick in this mid lane, or do they want to continue prioritizing the bot lane? Looks like so far Maiev gonna stay here on the mid with that Dragonite, whacking away the towers. They do have minions now joining up. A huge Root Silence. Can they get any damage onto the Tassadar? No. What a great play there by the Stukov player. Richard Gear locking down members, but not quite enough follow-up. Was hoping Junkrat could have gotten some more in there. Didn't quite happen. And it looks like Freelo might be deciding to work on this top lane. At least get rid of this well. Possibly take out a fort. And really help out your Sonya, who's been doing a damn fine job so far up against Malfiel. Which is one of those matchups you really hate to see if you're Sonya. And with only 5 seconds left and 4% health, this Dragonite will not stay alive long enough to finish it, but they will be able to have the damage there. A huge concussion mine thrown out onto Johanna, knocking her back, but she will be able to use Iron Skin back to safety. Here is a talent that I do want to talk about, and it's at level 13. It's Chattering Teeth. Wow, Tassadar getting caught out with the Silence. Richard Gear there again. And again, 7-2 now, the kill count. And let's take a look over at this kill death chart. And right now it is the Maiev player with 3 kills and 3 assists leading the way for Team Freelo here. 16's almost achieved, about a half level left, and 13 still not here for Team Maroon. They have to stay back safe by their walls, collect all the XP they can. Even in the face of these siege giants, they really can't push out because they don't have vision on their opponents. Two camps are now being picked up. You got the Siege and the Bruisers being worked on by Sonya, which are going to apply even more pressure into these lanes. It's all Team Freelo right now, and Team Maroon has to start rethinking their engagement pattern. They got to start looking to this Hanzo Coca-Cola to start making some plays. He has the Dragon's Arrow. That engagement tool, along with the Blessed Shield from Johanna, might be their option to get back in this game. Let's look at Time Dead. It's been Tassadar face on the mat for 55 seconds. And of course, if we look at the siege damage, he was leading the way and he still is leading the way for his team. So all this siege being missed when he's dead, they have to keep that Tassadar alive. Here it is, bot side wall, the same push we saw earlier. Siege Giants and Knights timed together here by Team Freelo. They want to make their push with their 13 talent advantage. Here's Maiev moving forward, Umbra Bind. Gonna connect onto Agarda with the taunt and the silence, but not enough. The Warden's Cage is gonna miss, but stuck in the quarters, Agarda. Malfeo really in trouble and will fall. A huge silence there by the Malfurion. Locking in three members is Johanna pulling back with Condemn, but she's going to fall. A two for nothing so far. Team Freelo with the lead. Blackout on the Junkrat falling low, and so is Coca-Cola, but Hanzo able to leap over his tower to safety. Uses a tap. He's still in this fight. I think he did use his Dragon's Arrow there, and Tassadar already uses Archon, so there's no ultimates available right now if you are on the side of Team Maroon, and they just have to start looking at backing up here because that was just way too much damage. They lost two. The shrine phase has spawned. I don't know how they push out without their level 16 talents right now. They just need to keep soaking. Tassadar is going to play it aggressive, though. We're going to keep an eye on this. Varian waiting in the bush. Does he see him? He does. Is he going to use a taunt? He doesn't even need to. His dragon is picked up mid by Team Freelo, and now is time to get one of these keeps down. The walls are down on mid and bot. Do they want to? Tassadar caught out again. The silence well played by Richard Gear, and without that secondary support and that Archon, this Dragon Knight is going to have a much easier time sieging down this keep. All five members here from Freelo. Concussion Mine knocking back the Malfurion. Let's see if they want to go core after this because there's still 18 seconds and this is going to start falling really quickly. Whacking away is Maiev onto this keep. It does fall. Where do they go next? Do they want mid keep? Do they want core? Looks like the rotation's to mid, and I am a very big fan of this play. You're not quite there yet. Tassadar almost alive. Get the value you can. This keep is it right now. The Dragon Knight still has plenty of health. 25 seconds. This keep is definitely going to fall. Make it two keeps on this dragon phase for Team Freelo. And now they can look at the late game strategy they want to pull out because they have all the catapult pressure. And it's only 13 minutes into this one, folks. Dragon Knight still born on this map. 5 seconds left. 7% health. They're working on the core. The shielding is still there and taking damage. A huge Twilight Dream. It's going to be really low. That variant, and there it is. The last right's gonna secure a kill. Malfiel getting it for his team, but Edgardo is falling low now. The shield from Tassadar gonna keep him up. He's able to re-engage onto this Sonya. Does he have that finishing kill onto Tythel? No, does not. Able to scoot away is Johanna, or excuse me, the Sonya. But you get your kill, and that's the confidence you need. You got your 16s now, and you have a man advantage on the map, so they're able to play aggressive. They're able to move into this siege camp right now, and they can begin to make the comeback start. They, of course, have to worry about the catapult pressure. They do have a Tassadar who has now moved into Psionic Echo, which will help tremendously in the wave clear department. He also has finished his Psy Infusion at level 1 earlier in the game, so these are going to be doing a chunk of damage to all of these minions in lanes. No one's soaking top lane right now, but Tassadar, knowing his team is behind, working up there. It's a pretty fat wave. He wants to make sure his team gets the XP, but bot side is going to be an issue if Maiev can find this flank, and Skigga might be looking for it. No. Gonna hold the mid triangle right now, waiting for his team to push forward and continue the pressure they have built up. They want those level 20s, and they're doing a great job of being patient here. I really appreciate this out of Team Freelo. A lot of times you see teams pushing forward with that 19-17 level lead, but you really want to get the talent tier at level 20 before you take the big fight that could cause your team a dragon, and a good push could cost your team a keep on the other side. So playing it patient, knowing the game they gotta play, this map is heavily in their favor. All they have to do is keep these lanes marginally pushed forward and keep Team Maroon on their back foot that they've done such a good job of over the last 7 minutes or so in this map. Right now, it looks like Tazstar looking to find some members. I don't know if he has his reveal, and there it is, but does not find anyone. Bruiser's picked up by Team Freelo, and Bruiser's on the other side, gonna be quickly snatched away by Team Freelo to match. Dragon shrines have spawned. Bot side is all Team Freelo. All four members in that four-man are down there. Sonya in the triangle, along with plenty of Junkrat traps. Will anyone walk into it? Chattering Teeth connecting onto Tassadar. He's not scared. More Chattering Teeth being thrown out. He's got three of them on the map at all times now. Another connecting onto Tassadar. This is getting very annoying, and it's slowing down the rotation tremendously for Team Maroon. However, they are able to walk onto this bottom shrine and collect it. It's Coca-Cola waiting there, and it's all because Team Freelo is being patient. They don't want to die here, but that's just what happens. Skigum, the Junkrat, falling before level 20, and now it's time for Team Maroon to make their comeback begin. They have the bot shrine currently. They have to make their way up top onto this Maiev. Can they get up there, control the top shrine? But they're working as a team. They know they can't split out, and it's gonna give up this bottom shrine, and gotta keep an eye on Core. Two catapults there right now working on shields. They'll be fine. Minions have spawned to clear those away. Let me get a sip of this drink. Delicious. All right, top being picked up by Johanna. And camp's going to be cleared out here. So they're doing a really good job of getting the levels they need. But right now, again, it's going to be the Tassadar falling once again. Now 11 kills. For Team Freelo, and here's a big engagement with the Warden's Cage. Edgardo, the Malfiel, the one in trouble. Will the silence come down from Richard Gere? No, because he's being zoned in the back line. There's a kill. That's one picked up for Team Maroon. Excuse me, now there's two, three fallen for Team Maroon, and three fallen for Team Freelo. So this has been a 3-for-3 fight, and considering Tassadar was already dead, you gotta give that fight in favor of Team Maroon there. And here's Blackout finally showing up, gonna try to work down Coca-Cola, but can't quite find him. Okay, so even strength on the map, it is 2-2. Sonya picking up top, and no one's here to punish a Junkrat. Will that blind come out? It does. Blanket able to lock that down from getting captured, but Iron Skin's been used. They got to be careful here if you're Blanket, because some CC coming out from the Junkrat could be trouble if he gets one of those Chattering Teeth, but doesn't even need it. The big bombs taken at level 20. Cannonball is the talent, able to secure the kill there onto the Johanna, and now it's a dragon ready to push on Core. They're not even waiting for the team, or are they? Looks like they're being told to just hold up, be patient. We have Johanna down. Wait until we get the team here, and we'll push on to this Core together. I like this patience coming out from Team Freelo, knowing the situation. Although level 20s are now picked up, and Tassadar has that infinite Archon, Twilight Archon, picked up at level 20. So he can stay in the form as long as he wants, as long as he's able to keep basic attacking. And the Dragonite, as long as it's staying in range, will be able to do that. There's going to be a dimensional shift away. It is now down, but Dragonite onto this Core, falling low, 14%, 10%. Malfiel did a great job of ripping through the Dragonite, and the Warden's Cage coming down onto two members. It's the Tassadar trying to do what he can, but not enough, because this is a late game Junkrat who has so much damage, and Sonya in Wrath form. That's going to be game number one, picked up by Team Freelo. All right. Let's take a quick peek at this endgame screen. Tassadar, again, as mentioned, doing so much of the siege damage. But Blackout on the Junkrat, really putting in work, picking up 59k damage, and all the kills picked up by Sonya and Maiev were outstanding. I do have to give insane props to Richard Greer in that match because he was able to silence so many heroes inside those Warden's cages, and a few really good rooted silences that helped lock down members for the variant to show up and get the stuns and the taunts rather. Just a really outstanding game from start to finish played there by Team Freelo. So we're going to take a short break. I'm going to be right back. Our next map is going to be Cursed Hollow. Ladies and gentlemen, do not go anywhere. Hang with us. I'm Murda. We'll see you soon. All right, we are back, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for hanging out during the break. Sorry, totally mistyped OKR into the Twitch chat. Mistype, sorry chat, LOL. All right, looks like Team Freelo's ready. Waiting on an R from Team Maroon, and we'll get into this game. While we have a moment, I do want to once again talk about the bit donation goal at the bottom of your screen right now. You'll see it. Every bit you donate will go towards the Regen Invitational that will take place right before Season 5 of NGS. So if you loved the event that happened before Season 4 and you want to see it come back, throw some bits in chat. Right now, if you're a Twitch Prime subscriber, you can go in and buy 500 bits for just 99 cents. And ladies and gentlemen, it will be the best 99 cents you have ever spent in your life. The event was an absolute blast last month when we ran it. I'm really excited to hopefully bring it back to you guys again. Here we are. Cursed game Hollow. Number two. Cursed Hollow. Draft starting up. Team Freelo took game number one on Dragon Shire. What are we going to see here in game number two? Cursed Hollow, a totally different map, a totally different style of play. A lot of teams like the macro style. Of course, you want to be able to get the curses out for your team, so having a good team fight around those tributes will be very important for both these teams as well. The first ban will be played by Team Freelo, as this was the map selection by Team Maroon here tonight. If you guys don't know, Team Maroon comes from the Texas A&M College. I'm not positive. I'm assuming, though, they played in Hero of the Dorm. If you guys know the answer to that, feel free to type it in the chat and let your fellow viewers know. But one would assume that they do come from Heroes of the Dorm. And we are glad to have them here in NGS playing in Division A West. They are currently the points leader going into this, but with one map already taken by Team Freelo, if Team Freelo takes this map number two here on Cursed Hollow, Team Freelo will move into first place with 9 points and a clean sheet on their schedule so far through the season. They have not dropped the map to this point here in Season 4. Garrosh the ban once again by Freelo. Must have a read on a player here from Maroon, or they really just don't want to play against it. Garrosh, one of those heroes that is absolutely insane. Murda trolling, please report him. Okay. All right. There we go. I'm going to throw the poll out there. You guys saw it in game number one. This one will say who will win Cursed Hollow. So if you want to decide who your favorite team is, exclamation point vote, throw a zero or a one after that, and you will be voting for your favorite team. And sometime towards the middle, I might pop it up, or maybe after the game, we'll see. Phoenix gonna be banned out by Maroon, which signals over to Freelo, and there we go. We got a bit, a cheer from the loyal trader 1444. He says, "Here you go, my doggy. It's all I got left, and every bit counts." Thank you so much, loyal trader. Very much appreciated. Every single bit will go towards that prize pool. So keep them coming in, ladies and gentlemen. Hanzo, and a new follower, Tax1K, what up, man? Casted you last night, right? Pleasure having you over here in my stream hanging out tonight. Hanzo was picked. It was played by Maroon in the first game, and Freelo wants to have it on their side this time, but here it is. The Stukov and the Maiev also going to trade teams, so definitely playing a little hot potato with some of these heroes here. See if they can make it work in the opposite direction, but yeah, I'm a huge fan of having my Evan Stukov, especially early game. They're just really, really strong. And thank you, the Imp 2010, saying they're a dorm team. I really appreciate you coming through into the chat, dropping that knowledge bomb for us. Thank you so much. All right, picks number two and three coming up for Team Freelo. I would definitely expect to see the Malfurion here, which would also be trading sides. I don't think they're going to want to move into Johanna. I really wouldn't expect to see that. They played the variant in game number one to a lot of success, and love this. You get the Tyrael to shut down the Warden's cage with the Sanct, and Diablo to put the hell in the cell. Another new follow. Appreciate it. Total psycho here. Played the Tracer last night and lit it up. If you guys don't know about Psycho, give this guy a look because he absolutely shreds on Tracer. Super high level. What was it, like 185 or something redonkulous like that? Definitely appreciate you stopping in tonight, man. And thank you for that follow. So yeah, Diablo going to be able to put some hell back into the cell on the other side. And when Tyrael's there as well, it's just going to be an insane harassment into this Warden's cage if that's going to be the play. Love having Tyrael. He's such a great defensive tool, especially here on Cursed Hollow when you get the Holy Ground and you're able to push people off of boss captures. It's just a great little utility hero that is often overlooked by a lot of teams, and I'm starting to play it more for my team. I think, again, he can really swing the tide of some fights, and when you have that tool up against a combo like my Evan Stukov, it will turn out in your favor. So keep an eye on the Tyrael here in this matchup. Malfurion was banned away, and I think that's wise because you already have your Stukov and your opponents don't have a healer yet, and it's going to force them onto something suboptimal perhaps. I think there's a few good selections here. They can still go into like an Alexstrasza, which can get some value here on this map. Of course, they could go into an Uther if it looks like they need it after these picks coming up. So I don't really mind them holding the healer. There's a couple things they could do. Even a Lucio, which is being played less and less, it might be good up against that Warden's cage if it gets dicey inside of it. Picks 3 and 4 here on the side of Team Maroon. Do they want to go with some of the picks we saw in game number one? That would have been like a Junkrat. We saw the Junkrat come out in game number one for Team Freelo, who played this comp. And the tank, of course, was Varian, and they had the solo lane as Sonya. Do they want to go in those directions? Do they want to take a cue from their counterparts who won game one against them? We'll see. 14 seconds left on the clock, and only time will tell. They do need a tank. And we have a disconnect, unfortunately, here. All right, ladies and gentlemen, I apologize. Let me get this sorted out. DC, I guess we will just restart draft with same picks when he returns. Okay, no big deal. You guys are cool in Twitch chat. We're going to wait for Skigum to return. Looks like he disconnected. And in the meantime, gives you guys time to chat with me. So let me know how you're loving NGS this season. Are there any teams in any of these divisions that people have to look out for? Maybe it's your own team. Maybe it's my team, which hasn't won a friggin' map the entire season. So probably not us. Sad face, feels bad man, Monka S. Maybe you have a team up in the Heroic Division. I am the division moderator for them. There's a lot of good teams. And if you haven't checked out the battles going up at the top of the leaderboard, it is a dead heat between so many of those teams. And I know a lot of your casters here in NGS have been doing a hell of a job finding all those games to cast for you. Heroic Division has been a success thus far. And it's only week two. Anything can happen there. All the teams are within reach of the top of the division. And moving into the playoff push, I wouldn't be surprised if like almost all of them have a severe opportunity to make it happen. Still waiting to get Skigum back in here. I might take a short break while we're waiting so I don't have to sit here, and I'll try to interact with you guys in the chat for a bit. So I will be right back. I'm gonna put up like a 2-minute timer. Hang with us, and this should be going as soon as we get one of these players back. So appreciate it. Thanks. Alright, ladies and gents, we're back. Skigum is back. Team Freelo and the Aggies from Texas A&M are back. We're ready to get this underway once again. I have instructed these teams to select the same heroes in the same order, so we're going to be able to blaze through half of this draft very quickly, and we should have the 3 and 4 picks. The only thing left, or not the only thing, but the next thing left to decide in this draft on the side of Team Maroon. There's the Garrosh and the Phoenix once again. I believe the first pick was Hanzo. Quickly snapped up. Then we had the Stukov and Maiev. There it is. Now on the other side, it was Diablo and Tyrael. The bans were Malfurion and... I'm not remembering what this last ban was. Dahaka, of course, my favorite hero, is banned away. And here we go, back to where we left off. Team Maroon deciding on what they want to do with these 3-4 picks. We already saw the Maiev and Stukov. We talked about how they need to set up a tank. They need to set up a solo laner. And they need to set up some sort of follow-up damage with this Maiev. And what direction do they want to go with it? I'm not quite sure yet. There's so many options they can go. Tanks available. Still have an ETC out there. And a Nubrax out there. Muradin's out there. I think Muradin might be a pretty decent pick. Can stun out the Sanctification if it's played well. Very sturdy too as well. Will have trouble dying to Hanzo. More so than some of the other tanks. Like in a Nubrax would just get shredded. So it's completely not an option. I think ETC is also going to struggle against that front line of Diablo and Tyrael. They're gonna go Medivh and Tychus. Here he is. Bobo, if you're still out there. Medivh. Love it, absolutely love it. Here on Cursed Hollow, one of his better maps. The vision he provides, the Leyline Seal that he can throw out. of course, he could also throw the Polybomb inside the Warden's Cage to stop any sort of Sanctification going out. So there are a few new interrupts onto the Tyrael, which I think they desperately needed. And it is also taken away from the possibility of having that Leyline Seal APOC combo on the side of Team Freelo. So I'm a huge fan of this pickup. I think Medivh's going to do wonders here. And of course, having Tychus up against Diablo, they don't quite have all the lockdown they need yet. They might need another stun out of their tank. I think Muradin could do the job there. But if Tychus can lock in some minigun, he's going to shred through Diablo and Tyrael like butter. So I'm a huge fan of having Tychus here. And of course, the Odin, another one of those tools that'll work out great. With that Maiev, Lee, the healer, Panda chick, Panda girl, Panda lady, she coming through, Team Freelo, no fear at all, playing the Panda, gonna get the blinds onto the Tychus, and even the Maiev, which will actually counter that Umbral Bind from connecting if she's blinded. So, very fun and utility-based pickup here, and Johanna once again selected by the Aggies. Game number 2 about to get underway. If you haven't voted in chat yet, exclamation point vote. Use 0 for Team Freelo. Use 1 for Team Maroon. Who's going to win this map number 2? Cursed Hollow. This is for all the marbles to be at the top of the division here. If Maroon can take the split, they remain on top. If Team Freelo wins Cursed Hollow, they will be your new division leaders in Division A West. So a bit on the line here. It's still early in the season, of course. But having that confidence moving forward throughout your divisional play goes a long way. And if you're Team Freelo, you are yet to drop a map yet. So you have a lot of confidence going into this, and you can see why, because the synergy played by these players in game number 1 was top tier, especially in this division. Almost no missteps in game number 1, and I wouldn't expect anything less here in game number 2. Blackout returning onto his Junkrat we saw in game number 1, and that's going to be your impact hero here to watch out for. Very excited to see him play that hero again here in game number 2. All right, and on the left-hand side, once again, we do have Team Freelo. Hollis going to play the Tyrael. Tithil on the Diablo. Skigum going to play Hanzo. Nice Richard Gere on the Lili. And, Blackout, as mentioned in the preload here, into the map on that Junkrat once again. On the right-hand side, we have Team Maroon, Texas A&M Aggie, showing up here in NGS. Space Bacon on the Stukov. Edgardo GL on Tychus. Blanket going to play Johanna once again. Samuel on the Maiev, and up in the air, it is Medivh, going to be played by Coca-Cola. Yeah, always tough calling out names when you can't see him there, when he's flying in the air pregame, that Medivh. All right, let's take a peek at some of our level 1 talents. We, of course, have Justice for All picked up by Tyrael, which will help him tremendously in that solo lane. He's already up there right now getting some soak done. And the wave clear was very strong by Team Maroon, working down that wave quickly. But yet to rotate to either one of these lanes. They're just hanging out. They are going to send Tychus top and Maiev bottom. We'll see if Edgardo can get any value here on the Tyrael. But as mentioned, that Justice for All is one of those talents that will really help Tyrael keep his minions alive, especially through the chain gun damage there by the Tychus. So winning lane early, and partly because he was there early, is going to be Tychus. Red team draws first blood. Oh, wow. Don't even know where he died. Must have been bottom. Already at it again. If you guys aren't throwing T-Tors in chat, you're not doing your job. Just like me, I'm not doing my job. C-Shy is going to be picked up as we're looking at here by Skigum and Richard Gere. And they will be pushing opposite side from the tribute. So will they decide to hold this for a minute, which I'd like to see out of them? Lili just going to slowly work it down, so I'm not going to bother looking at that. But do keep an eye on if she wants to capture it. Nothing else really going on around the map. Looks like Lili will capture it. And with Edgardo already falling to half health, not too much she can do here in terms of defense when those show up. Diablo in a bit of a pickle here. Medivh will have him scouted, walking right up into a bush where Johanna and the Stukov could have tried to interrupt him a bit there, but doesn't. Medivh now scouting out some knights. So, very macro-heavy play coming out already by Team Freelo. Showing up now is Maiev. Blackout, the Junkrat player, also going to show up here. Medivh throwing down the portal so Space Bay can get through. Blanket also going to be here. Can he get in the portal in time? Does not. But they do have a positional advantage onto this Night Camp. This will be a 4v4 fight. The charge in by Diablo onto Medivh. The flip. There's the silence coming out from Space Bay and going to shut down any sort of engagement attempt. So they're able to scoot away. The portal is there by Medivh, and all four members of Team Maroon able to escape with their lives. But the Knights do go over to Team Freelo just ahead of this tribute. And up top, the Giants are still there. One of them is pretty healthy. One of them is about to fall. It's definitely going to make Tychus late to show up to the party here on the bottom. So I might not want to jump in here if I'm Team Maroon. You definitely want to make sure that you clear out the mid and the top with all this pressure pushing on. Those knights are super healthy. And just falling now is that Siege Giant up top. But down here on the bottom, Medivh having a full scout on Team Freelo. Will there be a play? They got to wait for Tychus to show up. Clicking on the tribute is Skigum. Medivh will likely pop down to interrupt that if they want to play. But there it is. A blind coming out from Johanna will be the interrupt. And the Umbral Bind now connecting onto Diablo. But he very carefully walks forward in line with the Maiev. Portal onto the back line from Medivh. Not able to get too much work done there. And here it is. Tychus showing up. Gonna put damage onto the Tyrael. The silence is well placed by Space Bacon. No one able to walk through this right now. And all the members from Team Freelo are around half health. They're gonna have to give this up. Medivh. Coca-Cola is able to click it. No. Actually, Junkrat able to get some mines across. And now falling low after taps is gonna be Team Maroon getting flipped over as Tychus. He's in big trouble if he can't get out of here. The Umbral Bind gonna actually secure a kill on the other side. The Tyrael gonna fall, but here's his straight value. Doesn't quite finish off the Johanna using Iron Skin to her safety. Diablo wants more though, and Samuel is the target he's looking at. Ain't gonna be able to get it. Johanna once again able to interrupt with that shield glare, and this tribute has now been about 2 minutes of exchange here. Currently Team Freelo in the better position. Heroes having to back out from Maroon, and they will give up tribute number one. Very gutsy play from both sides, but the end of the day, it's Team Freelo picking it up and they are slightly ahead in terms of XP. Wow, what a flip. Didn't quite get the wall bang. Maya able to scoot away using Umbral Bind to pull Diablo with her. Both teams are so even in this, but the bot lane is being led by Junkrat. Blackout down there with no one responding, so level 7s will be picked up by Freelo first. And let's take a look. The W build is being continued by Hanzo. And now we're seeing Big Az. The Steel Trap's radius is growing, and he's going into that build once again. He loves his trap build. Call him the Trap Queen. Blackout here doing work on the Junkrat, but here he's getting flanked by Maiev. But he uses his own Concussion Mind to safety before the Umbral Bind can come out to pull him close. What a play. Blackout showing comfort on this Junkrat once again. Tribute number two, set up in the bush early, is going to be Maroon. They get the Umbral Bind onto Diablo. He's trying to do what he can to flip members. The silence is great from Space Bacon once again, shutting down that choke point there so the Lili cannot show up. Gonna have to take the long way around is Richard Gere. And a huge portal, four people coming through, make it five. They're looking for this engagement with Maiev. Falling low is the Diablo. Can they finish him off? No, the silence is good again to split the team. Will they find any heroes that can fall here? Edgardo on the front line looking with that Tychus, cannot find it. Taps will be used by Freelo, but will they be able to interrupt this? Space Bacon looking for the channel. No, they won't get it. And Hanzo, gonna be the one who falls. A great portal again. And they're gonna pick up a two for nothing right now. They could get more because there it goes. Tyrael falling as well. Three for nothing. And the boss is right here. Do they want to go for it? We'll see if the call is made. And looks like they're gonna walk past the boss. They don't want anything to do with it. Back to lanes, work on level 10s pretty soon. 1-1 on Trivs, ladies and gentlemen. Do you want to note that whole time, Siege Giants were pushing top. So the macro pressure is being continued continuously by Team Freelo. They're working on another one. They have this W build Hanzo who absolutely destroys these camps, and they're using it to the best of their ability. Mid lane, Diablo just getting soaked, not worried a damn bit about this combo of Johanna and Stukov. And now here it is. They're going to start working on a boss. Hanzo, no one keeping eyes on this, and he is destroying this boss along with Blackout, Richard Gere, and Hollis. This boss is down within about 20 seconds max. Even Medivh didn't see it. There's a boss pushing down bot lane. This trip is going to be top. Diablo waiting to try to poke it out for as long as he can, waiting for his team to show up. And he gets the wall bang through the little choke point there over the wall. And now set up is going to be Blackout. But the Umbral Bind into the Warden's Cage and the silence from Stukov. This is going to be more kills. There's going to be the Sanctification, though, holding them steady for just a little bit. But is it enough? I don't think so. They're falling extremely low. The Odin has been popped by Edgardo. And he's walking forward looking for some kills. But he will not find it. The portal on to the tribute. They can't click it though. They tried clicking on the tribute and it put them back through the portal. So Medivh gonna have to fly across, and it gives time for Freelo to catch up and finding the Medivh all alone is Diablo. And now a huge concussion mine gonna knock Tychus into some trouble. Edgardo falling low and Hanzo looking for the kill. There's the Riptire trying to chase him down. Will it get there in time? No, the swipes were great, but the Dragon's Arrow will finish it off, and the Riptire is able to move forward onto a three man and did a ton of damage there. So that's a two for nothing right now. After the re-engagement, they used taps, showed back up, and all because of that portal. Team Maroon was not able to click on it. The whole time we had the boss pushing bot, was able to get a wall. The Siege Giants did a decent job of clearing it up, but with members down and a Hanzo on the side of Freelo, here's another boss picked up, and they got two tributes. They can siege up top with this because the tribute next spawning will be here on the side of Team Freelo on the top side here. So they can play this very safely right now. Hanzo playing far back. The Lili is just showing up. Diablo looking to soak a bit in mid. I think he has full souls. He does. So not quite sure why they're leaving Diablo split, but he will be showing back up. On the bot side, this Siege Giant will go unchecked because the minions cannot reach him here on this map. Concussion Mind being played. Blackout looking for it. currently sitting at 5 out of 7 with the steel trap. Here's the engagement. Odin started. Portal in. There's a huge, the RQE by Diablo locking in the Medivh. The huge Riptire going to secure a kill there onto Maiev. And Odin, the line of defense that's left, but Diablo is being very aggressive with these wall banks. Tyrael doesn't care. He's going to be able to... Ooh, didn't end up hitting a hero with that, I don't think. At least didn't do enough damage to be considerable on these low health targets. But it is going to be a curse in favor of Team Freelo. They're your winners from game one. They have the lead here in game number two, and they're definitely going to be getting more of these structures down with the curse here at 10 minutes into this game number two. It's going to be mid lane that's going to be worked on. Hanzo clearing out all the minions. Blackout trying to do what he can to keep this fort controlled. Moving forward right now, a five man from Team Arun looking to defend this, not able to quite do it. They get the fort down, and Diablo's down on the bottom side working on another fort. His team's going to have to show up because a Medivh portal on top of him could be trouble. Teams are at full strength. Tychus is actually split up top because that keep wall is taking way too much damage right now. So this is a 5v4 advantage on the bot side with level 13s for Team Freelo. Will they find it? Tyrael looking for the holy ground, didn't find it. Is able to start working on these siege giants. Definitely going to help them in the post-curse sieging here. They will have about 8 seconds left. All members here for Freelo. Will they find a wall? Siege giants already working on that top tower. They will drop one. Curse expiring, but they are not afraid to be here. No minions currently, so they are going to start taking some tower damage. Here's the portal, the engagement coming, the flip immediately by Diablo, locking out Blanket, but his team is split. There's the Sanct inside the Warden's cage, and a huge Riptire going to lower the health of a lot of members. The cup's falling from Lili now. Going to get all the health back for a team. Diablo doing a great job. Going to finish off the Maiev there. The flips and the wall stuns have been on point. There's another one. Also zoning Medivh out from his portal, but he does find his way in, but not before Junkrat can secure the Medivh and stacks are reset again on his Master's Touch. And here we go, ladies and gents. Freelo has time with a 5v3 to work on this keep. Siege Giant still here. Tythel on the Diablo, taking a lot of damage. Has to get Cleanse to back away, so Cleanse will be down. They don't have it from Lili anymore. But the other thing that people don't have anymore is a bot keep. If your team are ruined, that is the first keep of the game. Structure advantage 6-2 in favor of Team Freelo. And I believe this boss will be spawning soon. And there it is, right on time. Boss spawning for Freelo into an open lane. 13-15. So if you're Maroon, you're looking for this fight right now. Looks like Freelo's aware. They're not trying to play this too aggressively. See if Medivh can scout them here on this night camp right now. Moving forward, finds it. Does he want to use his polybomb? Doesn't. Okay, so knight's picked up by Freelo. They're waiting patiently for their level 16. Medivh keeping eyes on the boss. And Maroon, the Aggies from Texas A&M, desperately seeking the XP they need to catch up here, just like in game number one. They're getting absolutely demolished in these team fights and falling behind in XP in both of these. The macro pressure has been on point. And here they go to work on the boss yet again. Hanzo, there's Skigum, ready to get started. Medivh giving scouting here. Will Maroon catch up? Looks like they're moving in as quickly as they can, but can they make it here in time? Junkrat trying to scout with some of his grenades. The boss has been captured, but it's being shut down right now. That polybomb is doing great work. The Warden's Cage comes in. They end up picking kills. The Odin is really good. The silence is even better. Space Bacon holding it steady. There comes the APOC by Diablo, but it's not enough. Two members will fall, and the boss is stolen. Make it a 3-0. What a gutsy play there by Team Maroon. That's exactly what they needed to get back in this game, and they made it happen. The boss deal, the triple kill. They even get a tribute, putting them at 2 points right now, but they do have to keep an eye back at their keep because Knight's on that keep wall mid, and bot lane catapults working their way past where the keep once was, but they know they need to get value when value is there for them. They want their 16s, and they want this keep wall here on the bot side, so they're pushing in with their boss. They have all five members here. There's the polybomb coming out onto just one member. The silence being held by Stukov. He's gonna throw out some cues to keep his members alive. They need to stay here with this boss. They need their 16. The boss trying to slam but doesn't hit the tower, so a little bit slower here on the siege. They're very close to picking up 16s, but they're playing it safe. They have a portal disengagement. They're going to use it. They're back to safety. The knights at mid are dead, but not before the wall is destroyed. This is a huge tribute. 16s are about to trickle in. It's not quite there for Maroon yet. They can't take this fight until they get it, but Maiev moving forward has to use the Vault of the Wardens to escape a Diablo stun, but rooted and stunned. Maiev is gonna fall early. Didn't get the Warden's cage out in that fight. The Polybomb was good. There's the Riptar being used, and it didn't do quite enough on anyone. The Odin is now a threat, a huge threat. Team Maroon really starting to work out some heroes to charge in by Diablo. He's the most sturdy hero on this team. Gets the stun, gets the sanctification, the holy ground coming out as well to prevent any of these backings. It's going to be a 3, make it 4 for nothing. And Tychus, the only one still alive. Junkrat will likely be able to finish it off because there's Chattering Teeth. And the Lord of Terror, Diablo, picking up the kill. GGs are thrown out in chat. Will that be it? I think it might be. More Chattering Teeth on the map. Diablo looking to flip them into there. There's a blink played and the Umbral Bind. Will this be any sort of damage? It's not quite enough. Maiev also gonna fall. Another member down for Team Maroon. And here it is. Core down to 80%. They're working on it, but they are low health. Stukov looking to do what he can. Can he hit this silence? No, doesn't get it. 60%. Minions are now here with the catapult. 50%. 40%. Members are now spawning. 30%. Will a defense be made? Falling down out of 20%. Inside 10%. Will they stay? They're not leaving. Ladies and gentlemen, Team Freelo are your new Division A West leaders. 9 points on the scoreboard, and what a show here tonight out of them. Very well played, executed without a cinch in their armor, and here it is. They're your new Division leaders. I'm gonna see if we can pull in, I wanna talk to Hollis or Blackout. We'll see which one of them wants to come in. I kind of want to talk to Blackout. We'll see if he'll come. Hey, mind doing an interview? What a game. What a game. Oh, I do want to say thank you for the host to Jason. Let me replay that. Detected. I don't think that went out. No. Jason, you the man. Really appreciate it. I hope your game was good. Blackout is not responding, so I'm going to try reaching out to Hollis. Let's see. Want to do an interview? View? W? Here we go. Great game. Great game. Oh, there's Blackout. Okay. Yep. NGS chat. Alright, let's see here. NGS Discord. Looking for lobby one. Cool, cool, cool. One is fine. I'm a loser interviewer. Anyway. Alright, joining me here in chat is your Junkrat MVP. It's Blackout. Dude, well played tonight. Obviously, a lot of comfort on this hero. Is this something you're looking to do more often?
Actually, it's something that I kind of start my team wanted me to play more. So I've been spamming him a lot and having a lot of success with him.
Yeah, the Chattering Teeth build, not what you see frequently, but you made it work, especially on Dragon Shari. You hit him in the triangle. It disrupted a lot of rotations. It secured a lot of kills, having the variant taunt behind it. Is that a build that you're running frequently, or is that kind of something you adapted for these matches?
I would say I run it pretty frequently, not all the time, but the zoning potential in like the mid to late game is so strong that I prefer it most of the time. I just preferred it to the damage. Skigum usually puts out enough damage on Hanzu especially that I don't have to worry about getting a little bit extra.
So yeah. Let's talk a bit about your teammates, Gigum. Of course, he had the disconnect during draft that we forgave him for. Yeah. But he came out in game number two and played that Hanzo. And the boss control and Merc control in general was a big focal point for your team. What was going through your minds during that? I think you guys were at level 15 and they were coming in at level 13. What happened there in that fight?
A little bit of miscommunication, I think, and mispositioning. I don't know what happened, if I got polybombed or something during Riptire, where the Riptire wouldn't explode for some reason. But yeah, they executed that a little bit better than we did. And we kind of saw it coming, but we decided to stay on it with Sank and the concussion vine. It didn't go our way.
Yeah, it didn't end up making a difference in that game because obviously the kills kept coming out. Game number one was just absolutely dominant on Dragonshire. You guys took that keep, I think, 8 minutes into the game. It was very early. And then maybe it wasn't 8 minutes. It felt like 8 minutes at least.
Oh, that was the double keep.
With the Dragon Knight. I think it was the second Dragon Knight of the game, maybe. But here on Cursed Hollow was even quicker in terms of destroying that keep. Is this, like, the macro-heavy play, is that something your team's really trying to focus on this season, or is that just something that naturally comes for you guys?
I would say a little bit of both. For some of us, it comes, like, really naturally, and we've been working on a lot. We actually scrim with our, scrim partners, Average Joes, quite a bit from Division A East. And we have a couple others, but we've been working a lot on our macro calls, and everybody plays like really solid when we have, when our comms are solid, our rotations are good. Usually, we had a few occasions where we got picked off.
It seemed like your comms were on point throughout most of it. I think that maybe the boss was a little miscommunication, but. You guys were very disciplined, waiting for level 20s to get picked up in game number one before you took a big fight on one of those shrines. And the double like camps, the siege and the bruisers pushing down bot lane twice, that really helped you secure all the structures there. It was just really well played and well thought out from your team. Tell me a bit about your team. How'd you guys meet? Is this like your first time doing this? Or give us a story of Team Freelo.
So me, Hollis, and Richard Gear have been playing together for probably like 2.5, almost 3 years now, with different variations of teams, you know. And Hollis brought over Tyfel and Skigum from another team that he's played with. And we just kind of like a few months back just said, hey, you know, like Cheer League's coming up. You guys want to have a team for that? Sure, we'll play together. Cheer League, rip. So we're playing MGS, and actually we like the format here a lot better.
Awesome to hear. Yeah, a lot of people were disappointed with Cheer League shutting down or going on hiatus or whatever you want to call it. But I mean, once you go NGS, you never go back. It's such a great
community. It brings all the teams from both sides together too, and it creates a bigger community.
Yeah, absolutely. A lot of people just bring so much to the community. It's such a community-driven league, which I think Cheer League struggled from in the past. We're very glad to have you here, speaking as a moderator for NGS. Definitely thrilled to have you guys here. Hopefully you're thrilled because Team Freelo is the new division leader in Division A West. How does that feel?
Pretty good. We didn't really know what to expect coming into this season, like how we would do, where we would place. Like, we weren't even having like good scrims for a while, but like we just, I don't know what happened in the last couple months, but we've been like you pointed out, our macro game has been a lot better. But it's fun. We enjoy doing this a lot, so like that's what it's all about, really. So
well, before
winning, of course.
Oh, of course, that's the most important part. Before I let you go, Blackout, I do want to give you an opportunity to give some shout-outs. Maybe it's team members or friends hanging out in Twitch chat. So, floor is yours, my friend.
I have a few. First are my team. They're great. I love playing with them. They're so much fun. Our research department, Hollis, the captain, for scouting out our opponents for tonight, and it kind of gave us really good insight into our bans and draft strategy. Our scrim partners, Average Joes, and then our our sub, Pie Maker, for like filling in for me when I can't make it. So.
Awesome, awesome.
Yeah, and hi, Mom.
Hi, Mom. How you doing? All right, that's all we have for you tonight. Team Freeload takes the 2-0 over Team Maroon, moving them into first place in Division A West. Joining me for this interview was Blackout. He played the Junkrat tonight. He was your MVP of the evening. Signing off, it's Murda, and have a great night, guys. See ya.